And we'll hear a bit from the clinical trial world in cachexia from Dr. Jeff Crawford.
Thank you. I'm Jeff Crawford. I'm a medical oncologist at the other university in North Carolina, Duke. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. I've been involved with clinical trials for a number of years and been very fortunate to be more recently involved with some cachexia studies we'll talk about. Some disclosures. I can't start without thinking about Ken Fearon. Ken died a year ago. It seems sometimes like days ago, sometimes an era ago, but he's been a major contributor to our field and would love to be here today. We'd love to have him here for his insightful comments, but you'll be hearing and have heard from him as we'll go along. So I thought I'd start with a case. This is a 72-year-old woman in my practice, presented with a cough and back pain, poor appetite, unintentional 10-pound weight loss. She was fatigued. She had to close her law practice. Had a minimal smoking history, no other comorbid disease. You can see her vital statistics there. Long and short of this is she was evaluated, had a stage 4 adenocarcinoma of the lung, and her treatment options were largely limited at that point to platinum-based chemotherapy. The oncologist was starting that and decided to refer her to a palliative care specialist, largely because of the work of Jennifer Kemmel a few years ago, published in the New England Journal of Medicine, which showed that integration of palliative care, as hopefully most of you know, at the same time as management of patients with advanced cancer, particularly lung cancer, not only improves quality of life, but also survival. This is now being hopefully replicated in an alliance trial that's being done in a multi-center fashion. So, but at this point, we're left with managing her pain and cough and fatigue. What about her anorexia and weight loss? What do we do in clinical practice now? Do we get a nutrition consult? Do we recommend an exercise program? Is there some intervention like the gastrol acetate or some combination of the above? When you look to the our experts in the area, as seen in NCCN, you can see a long litany of potential interventions, but you can see most of these are, there we go. Most of these are evaluating the weight loss, trying to reverse the reversible causes of anorexia, reviewing their medications, looking for endocrine abnormalities, considering an exercise program, considering nutrition consults. Those in the field, I think, would like a little stronger recommendation and consideration here, and then reevaluating. So, and there's really no therapeutic intervention currently recommended. So clearly our field is really suffering for better direction, better studies, better guidance, and more consensus. There we go. So this is a definition that Ken and his colleagues developed, and Vicky's alluded to this already, just to come together about a consensus definition into the field of cancer cachexia, which I think still holds well today. A multifactorial syndrome defined by an ongoing loss of skeletal muscle mass that can't be fully reversed by conventional nutritional support leads to progressive functional impairment. We know in, again, work from Vicky and others showing that muscle wasting in lung cancer patients is very prevalent. You can see it's present. If we look at just low BMI, less than 18.5, that happens in a minority of patients. But if we look at muscle wasting, almost half our patients at diagnosis present with muscle wasting, and that's two-thirds by the time they're through their course of their illness. An important paper that hasn't been mentioned today, so I'm glad I got a chance to do this. Lisa Martin's work, taking some relatively simple measures, looking at BMI and looking at weight loss, combining those two, and looking at the impact that has on potential outcomes. This is some more than 8,000 patients with cancer in Canada and Europe, and looking at those variables and outcome, and following them for survival. I wonder why this is not, there we go. One can see here a diagram that shows on the x-axis the survival by BMI in months, from 13 months for high BMI patients to 4 months for patients with low BMI. On the other axis, on the y-axis, patients with no weight loss, 17.3 months down to 4.4 months. You just look at that. But if you put a grid together and grade this from grade zero in the white boxes down to grade 4 in the yellow boxes and look at outcome and divide it by performance status, you see a pretty dramatic effect. You see that for the good performance status patients, you have a 27.8-month survival for that group of patients with high BMI, no weight loss. On the other end, for patients with severe weight loss and low BMI, it's 6 months. And obviously, that's worse than the poor performance status. So these are easy measures and ones we really should incorporate in our practice that don't require body composition, but at least give us a direction on who needs further evaluation. So the end result of this, of course, the disease process leading to muscle mass has both clinical effects and metabolic effects, ultimately leading to a decline in independence, increased hospitalization, as you heard, decreased responsiveness to chemotherapy, and increased mortality. So there are a lot of complex interactions. We've touched on this a little bit, but this is a balance between muscle loss and muscle growth. And what I want to do is focus just on two agents that have been in the clinic recently. One is a selective androgen receptor modulator, which has an impact on blocking muscle loss. And the other is ghrelin on the other end, which can stimulate muscle growth. And we'll see different trial designs and different results, but I think some promise with both agents, more lessons for the future. So first, for the Enobosarm, it's a selective androgen receptor modulator. These are agents that have been developed to preserve the beneficial effects of androgen while removing those of higher risk. So this particular molecule has been designed so virilization, prostate hypertrophy, lipid effects have been dialed out while maintaining effect on muscle and bone. In the phase 2 trials, it looked like a very promising agent. We can see on the left, lean body mass, the phase 2B cancer cachexia trial, another study in elderly men and postmenopausal women, and a sarcopenia trial, all three of which showed that this oral agent compared to placebo had a significant impact on lean body mass. At the same time, physical function was measured by stair climb power in the first two trials and by a bilateral leg press in the third study, and again showing what appeared to be significant differences. So this led to the development of two randomized phase 3 trials that we were involved with. One of them was done in patients with advanced lung cancer getting platinum and a taxane regimen. The second was platinum and a non-taxane regimen. These were patients with newly diagnosed advanced stage lung cancer, good performance status. No criteria for weight loss was included per se. And you can see that the endpoints at day 84, the primary endpoints were what the lean body mass was by DEXA and physical function by stair climb power. That was also looked at day 147 in the two studies. So if we look at the lean body mass responder analysis, what one can see is that surprisingly in the control population getting chemotherapy alone, about a third of patients maintained their lean body mass or increased it. Whereas there was a difference statistically in favor of the Enobosarm-treated patients, but I think that effect was blunted by the effect chemotherapy had in a positive sense of the patient population. Now, interestingly, when you looked at the whole population, you could see quite a difference, however. The Enobosarm-treated group had about a 2-kilogram increase in lean body mass in the first study, about a 1 to 1.5 in the second trial, compared to the control population that had a decline. So there was clearly effect on lean body mass by these two studies with the use of Enobosarm. Now, looking at the continuous variable analysis for the efficacy endpoints, if you looked at stair climb power between the placebo and Enobosarm group, there was a statistical difference in the first trial with the taxane, highly statistically significant difference with lean body mass. That was also seen in the power trial as well, where there was a statistical difference here, but stair climb power failed to be validated in the second study. So unfortunately, the study didn't meet uniform endpoints and didn't meet the regulatory criteria that the FDA had and the EMA had, because they were looking for both a functional change as well as a lean body mass change. Now, I will say this, a lot has been said about this study. If one looks just at lean body mass responders, whether they were on chemotherapy alone or on chemotherapy plus Enobosarm, there is a relationship. You can see that lean body mass responders, those that maintained or improved their lean body mass, had an improvement overall in stair climb power compared to the non-responders. So the relationship exists, perhaps not strong enough to meet the endpoints. So let's talk about the ghrelin story. So ghrelin is an agent released by the stomach. It's a ligand for a ghrelin receptor. It produces the release of growth hormone. It stimulates a number of different pathways that help regulate body weight, lean body mass, appetite, and metabolism. Anamorlin is a orally active ghrelin mimetic receptor agonist, and in the phase 2 trial, it also showed significant effects on increasing mean body weight at 12 weeks in lung cancer. So the trials chosen for the development of this agent were also in lung cancer, but they weren't at the initial diagnosis. It was patients already with established cachexia who had lost 5% of their body weight or more. And they could be at diagnosis or at any point during their time course. And the patients were randomized to anamorlin versus placebo. Again, looking at lean body mass, you can see that in both trials, a significant improvement was seen in the lean body mass for both studies. Interestingly, though, they picked hand grip strength as their endpoint, and unfortunately showed no impact and a decline in hand grip strength in both. And we can talk a little about whether that was the best measure and what some of the limitations might be, but unfortunately, their functional endpoint was not successful. What was successful is an improvement in weight. You can see here a nice improvement in body weight in the anamorlin group compared to placebo in both studies, really. So that was significantly different. This is about a 3-kilogram increase over a 12-week period. Also, by the anorexic cachexia patient-reported outcome scale, that was significantly different, again, in both trials. If we look at fatigue, it appeared there was a significant difference in their fatigue scale in the first trial. It wasn't seen in the second study. Again, speaking to the difficulty of fatigue and its multimodal factors involved with it. So I was a discussant when this data was first presented, and I asked a crowd of colleagues about what they would do in this situation. If they had these trials, if they had these results and had this drug available that improved appetite and improved body weight and lean body mass with minimal toxicity, would they prescribe it in their practice? And the answer was pretty uniformly yes. Unfortunately, when the regulatory agencies looked at this both in the U.S. and in Europe, in the absence of a functional improvement, they felt that the data wasn't sufficient in and of itself for approval. So I think we're back to the drawing board a little bit. I think these are both still promising agents. Maybe we haven't used them in quite the right way. Maybe we haven't developed the clinical trials quite perfectly, and I'd be interested in comments you have. One of my residents and I are looking back at the data, and this is just from our trial with the power studies looking at the Enobosarm patients, but this is actually the control population, just the placebo group. We wanted to really understand, if we could, what the patient factors were associated with muscle loss, and what the factors associated with muscle function change. Clearly, these are patients starting treatment. Many of them had weight loss before, but if we look at the weight loss during treatment, there is a relationship between weight change and lean body mass. We saw over time some gaining, some losing. If we look at lean body mass as an endpoint and try to look at baseline characteristics, there are trends in some of the data, but the only thing that really fell out was the patients with more advanced disease had more significant change in lean body mass than did the patients with less advanced disease. But the other factors were not as statistically significant. When we look at the stair climb power, interestingly, taxane population had more of an impact. It seemed that had more of an effect on the muscle, at least by function. People that quit smoking had a bigger effect. Actually, this was a negative effect. So the patients that quit smoking more than a year ago had less of an improvement in stair climb power, and there were some other endpoints as well. So this is still a work in progress to try to understand, is there a subset of patients that are going to be more benefited by these interventions than others at the time of diagnosis? The other thing we've learned, and I think we've heard this today, change in stair climb power, change in lean body mass are not necessarily correlated, particularly over a short time interval like this of a matter of months. So it brings us back again to Ken Turin and concepts of pre-cachexia, cachexia, and refractory cachexia. What's the right time point to intervene? In the work of Anna Moreland, they approach these patients more at the cachexia or refractory cachexia stage. Our studies were done sort of in this window. Neither were totally successful. Both showed some impact, these agents, that could have been predicted from preclinical data. And I think, to me, it's still trying to correlate with the patient what the best functional outcomes are, how do we really show the effect and benefit of the agents, and what's the best population. And this is an algorithm also from that paper. So in summary, I'd say the cancer cachexia is prevalent diagnosis. The increase in frequency and severity during the disease and treatment course of our patients with lung cancer, but also most other advanced cancers. Muscle wasting and sarcopenia is central to cancer cachexia, both in the molecular and the clinical level, and impacts function and quality of life, treatment response and toxicity, and survival. Non-pharmacologic approaches really remain our mainstay. So nutritional counseling and physical training, exercise should be recommended for all our patients early in their disease course. And there may be selective pharmacologic interventions we have, but mainly at reducing depression, pain, and other factors that may be interfering. And I think there are promising approaches for earlier detection and monitoring, as well as new agents for treating this disease that hopefully will come forth in the years ahead. I'll stop there. Thank you.